Jacobins, Cordeliers, and Girondists. These are the three names that crop up when someone asks about the political clubs that were active during the Revolution of France between 1789 and 1799. Although there were actually over 1,500 clubs created throughout the Revolution, these three, all led by charismatic and outspoken leaders, dictated how the Revolution proceeded up until 1794. The three clubs had their own backgrounds, ideals, ideas, and ways of achieving what they desired. In June 1789, the Third Estate broke away from the Estates General and renamed themselves the National Assembly, and later, the National Constituent Assembly. Although every member of the National Assembly were pro-revolution, and all had fairly similar visions of a free future for the people of France, they were forming into factions, usually around an outspoken leader. These factions, or clubs, would decide the fate of the revolution for the next 5 years. The first major club to exist were the Jacobins, which formed around the time of the meeting of the Estates General in 1789. When the Third Estate broke away from the Estates General, the Jacobin club was strong, and at its head was the infamous Maximilien Robespierre. After the Jacobins came the Cordeliers, formed in 1790. They were led by Georges Danton and Camille Desmoulins, who possessed radical militaristic views towards the revolution. Less than a month after the formation of the National Assembly, Camille Desmoulins gave a speech to the people of Paris calling for uprising. He instigated the formation of the National Guard, and the next day the people of Paris stormed the Bastille prison. On the other side of the assembly were the Girondins, not a formal club, but more a united group of independents with the same views towards the revolution. The Girondins, in contrast to the Jacobins and Cordeliers, believed the best way to run the revolution was through diplomatic, non-violent means. Their most influential speaker was Jacques-Pierre Brissot. All the clubs wanted revolution, and what is ironic is that they wanted revolution so much and pursued their own goals so intensely that they all eventually became victims of the revolution themselves. If they wanted to be successful in their quest for a new France, it meant that they themselves were doomed. History tells us that anyone trying to take over a country inevitably make enemies, whether they be another major faction in a revolution, or once allies sharing the same goals, or even just a rapidly formed group of citizens seeking change, realizing that the current situation was worse than before the revolution began. One of these enemies will be able to get at them in the end. This is exactly what happened to the clubs of the French Revolution. The clubs had a profound effect on the general populace of France. Once the Bastille was stormed and the Third Estate, plus several nobles and clergy jumping on the revolution bandwagon, had formed the National Constituent Assembly, they were effectively running the country. The vast majority of people were pro-revolution and were therefore loyal to the Assembly and not to the King. One of the first documents approved by the National Constituent Assembly upon their formation was La Déclaration des droits de l'homme et du citoyen, the Declaration of the Rights of Man and Citizen. This piece of legislation was a document stating all of the rights and freedoms to be enjoyed by men. As a result, several groups came to the Constituent Assembly with problems when they weren't granted one or more of the articles stated within the declaration. One of these groups were the Jews of northeastern Paris. Their wish was to be treated with the same revolutionary freedoms and rights as everybody else, to be free from religious discrimination as stated in Article 10. No one shall be disquieted on the account of his opinions, including his religious views, provided their manifestation does not disturb the public order established by law. The petition was first brought before the Constituent Assembly on the 28th of January 1790, and full rights were granted in September 1791. The Jacobins were also influential in trying to feed the people. Prior to the revolution, the financial situation of France had been deteriorating badly for several years and worsened with the revolution. King Louis XVI had appointed several finance ministers in an attempt to bring France out of its troubles, but they had all failed. This financial strife, coupled with social unrest and discord which was occurring during the revolution, caused bread prices to skyrocket. People were starving and finding it impossible to acquire enough food to live. To combat this, the Jacobins introduced the Law of Maximum, which fixed the prices of bread and other necessities. This was supposed to allow the people to afford enough food to survive, but it was largely unsuccessful. This was because merchants were supposed to sell goods for less than it cost to make them. The merchants stopped selling their bread as they were unable to make a profit, causing the people to have to find their own food or go hungry. The clubs were instrumental in the formation of the National Guard in the first days of the revolution. the National Guard attacked feudal lords and the old aristocracy in the name of the revolution, fighting against an oppressive system that had been keeping the working class suppressed for hundreds of years. The people in general were only too happy to see change, pleased with the revolution, that is, until the terror began. From the start, Robespierre, the leader of the Jacobins, harboured a hatred for the Girondins. When the Legislative Assembly was formed on October 1, 1791, he could tell that the Girondins' views were far less radical than his own. The Girondins had given some power back to the king in the form of a constitutional monarchy. Robespierre thought that they were monarchists and against the true cause of the revolution, which was to be rid of the crown and the aristocracy. All he wanted was an excuse to purge the assembly of these counter-revolutionaries. He would get his chance. On the 10th of August, 1792, the Legislative Assembly ended as a result of the king using his power to veto laws against the will of the Jacobins. 3 days later, under the influence of the Jacobins and Cordeliers, citizens of France stormed the palace where the king and queen were under house arrest and sent them to the Temple, a fortress in Paris used as a prison. Seeing as the Legislative Assembly wouldn't work anymore, the National Convention was formed, a parliament of elected representatives, and France was declared a republic. Jacobins, Cordeliers, and many independents merge into one faction called the Montagnards, or the Mountain, still led by Maximilien Robespierre. Robespierre, Danton, and Desmoulins still harboured intense hatreds for the Girondins, who held the majority vote in the National Convention. But around half of the members of the new government were independents, voted in by their local community. There was now a way for the Montagnards to take control. Here again is the irony that for the revolution to occur, the main revolutionaries are doomed. As their goal consumes them, they can't think about long-term consequences, about their own survival. Over the next few months, the Montagnards made some huge gains. The September massacres occurred, where, over a period of 48 hours, 1,200 anti-revolutionary prisoners were executed. The Montagnards army then left and defeated Austria once and for all in October 1792, after a short war started by the Girondins in April of that same year, but they had not been able to win. Support for the Montagnards grew both within the National Convention and on the streets of France. In January 1793, the Montagnards outvoted the Girondins, and King Louis XVI was executed on the 21st of January. The Girondins' final mistake was to attempt to arrest and execute Jean-Paul Marat, a politician who hated the Girondins and had been giving them a lot of grief. He was acquitted of charges stating that he had called for widespread murder in his revolutionary paper. After this, the Girondins lost vast amounts of popularity, and on the 2nd of June, the Montagnards purged the convention of Girondins, sending dozens of them to the guillotine. On the 5th of September 1793, soon after the downfall of the Girondins, the Montagnards passed the law to form a revolutionary army in order to eliminate anyone opposed to the revolution. Records exist of the speeches given by the members of the National Convention that day. Pierre Gaspard Chaumette, an extremist revolutionary looking for violent means for protecting the revolution, proposed the idea, stating,
"Let this army be such that there remains in each city sufficient forces to restrain malicious people."
He was backed by Danton, who stated clearly the need to spend 100 million francs on the making of weapons to arm the citizens of the nation.
"Let it be the Republic that puts a gun into the hands of the citizen, the true patriot, and let the Republic say to him, the country entrusts its weapon to you for its defense."
The revolutionary army was formed 2 days later, all over France. The terror had begun. Over the next year, the Montagnards had a huge impact on the people of France. Their entire way of life had to change for them to avoid being arrested and executed for counter-revolutionary activity. What was once a victorious overthrow of the monarchy, a great victory by the people, had turned into a bloodbath. Anyone accused of suspicious activity could be sentenced to death, often without a trial. This would have caused huge amounts of fear within the people. Any old quarrels could mean you were wrongfully accused and executed. The people were forced to eat on the floor. No table manners were allowed. They could not wear clothes reminiscent of nobility or speak out against the authority of the convention. Any small breaches of conduct would easily grant any person a one-way ticket to Madame Guillotine. Robespierre and Danton set up the Committee of Public Safety, which is ironic itself, as its job was plainly to kill as many people as possible with little regard for their guilt for the protection of the true revolutionaries. During the terror, Robespierre became paranoid and sent anyone who he thought could oppose him straight to the guillotine, including Danton and several old Cordeliers, the remnants of the Girondists, and thousands of powerless aristocracy from the Ancien Régime. As is the nature with many absolute rulers, people started to revolt, this time against the National Convention and Robespierre. Robespierre's confidence dissolved. He was losing his tight grip on the people. The Thermidorian reaction soon followed on the 9th of Thermidor, or 27th of July, 1793, when the National Convention decreed for the arrest of Robespierre. He was arrested and guillotined without trial the very next day in the Place de la Révolution, along with dozens of his followers. The terror had ended with the execution of Robespierre. The revolution continued for another 5 years under a new government called the Directory, until the head of the army, Napoleon Bonaparte, overthrew the Directory over the days of November 9th to 10th in 1799. He was elected the first consul on the 12th of December, and the French Revolution was officially over. What we can learn from researching the French Revolution is that the instigators, the main people pushing forward, all fell by the wayside when someone outsmarted them. Nobody can lead a revolution without making enemies. They started off with three main clubs, all with the same ideals. A France where every man can be equal and be able to go somewhere in life, not just born and die in the same place, having gained nothing. In pursuit of these goals, all three clubs perished in the attempt. The Girondins were outsmarted and purged from the National Convention by the Montagnards, led by Jacobin Robespierre, who wanted total control. The Cordeliers, along with Danton and Desmoulins, were also killed by the Jacobins, as they were seen as a threat to Robespierre, who thought they might attempt to usurp him. Lastly were the Jacobins and Robespierre himself. They had terrorized the people of France for longer than a year, and had killed, unnecessarily, over 40,000 French citizens for the ultimate cause of freedom and justice. He was arrested and executed by angry Frenchmen, sick of oppression that the revolution itself had imposed on them. Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one gone, and another one gone. Another one bites the dust. Hey, hey, gonna get you too. Another one bites the dust.